Episode 8, Templum, Chapter 37, 15th July, 1099 AD, Jerusalem. Jean de Vézelay was a man of small stature, with soft, flabby cheeks and crafty eyes. At 57, he was old to be wearing the armor of a crusader. He put his survival over the past 3 years down to a lack of scruples and being careful never to end up in the front line of a battle. That didn't mean he didn't enjoy killing. In fact, this crusade was the best fun he had ever had. A Benedictine monk from Burgundy, son of a local count and a 14-year-old laundry maid, he managed to elevate himself to the knighthood through his eloquence, his denunciation of others, and a series of murders. All by himself, he had raised a force of 3,000 men to join in this crusade, and not a single one of them survived. Out of the army of 7,000 knights, 20,000 foot soldiers, and a mob of some 30,000 unarmed civilians who had gathered 2 years earlier in Constantinople, barely one quarter still lived. Shipwrecks, disease, famine, exhaustion, madness, the endless battles for Nicaea and the seventh-month siege of Antioch had eaten away at the greatest army the world had ever seen, like worms devouring a corpse. Those who survived felt like walking corpses, a starving, ragged band of Frankish crusaders, reduced to marauding across the Holy Land, committing murder after murder. After the conquest of Marat Anouman, they had been reduced to eating dogs and had even resorted to cannibalism. The adult Saracens were boiled in cauldrons after their stomachs had been sliced open in a search for gold coins. The children were impaled on skewers and roasted. On the 13th of July, Jean de Vézelay had finally reached the walls of the holy city itself with a force of barely 14,000 men. Their first attack had been easily repulsed at the cost of many men. Only after they had brought wood from Samaria and built siege towers, battering rams, and catapults, did they finally manage to take Jerusalem at the end of a 5-week assault. There were no words to describe the carnage that followed. The crusaders stormed the holy city like men demented, driving the fleeing citizens through Jerusalem's narrow alleys, slaughtering them like dogs as they ran. Babies were ripped from their mothers' arms and their skulls dashed against stone doorways. Women were brutally raped while their menfolk were stoned to death. Even the few remaining Christians in the city were not spared. A stinking stream of blood and guts flowed through the streets of Jerusalem and out into the valley of Kidron. On the Temple Mount itself, the crusaders massacred a crowd of 10,000 who had sought sanctuary there, as if the prophet himself was going to descend on Barak, his winged steed, to help them. It was as if the city exuded an insidious aura of evil that infected the air itself and stole into men's hearts, poisoning them with a demand for ever more blood, as if something lived deep beneath the city, breathing a hatred for humanity, a hatred for life itself. On the afternoon of this particular July 15th, Jean de Vézelay was sitting tired but happy atop a heap of corpses, looking up at the octagonal shape of the Dome of the Rock, the goal of their crusade. The Benedictine was covered in blood that stuck to the sparse hair of his tonsure and soaked his mail shirt, shone in the sunlight on his ragged clothes, and dripped from the sharp blade of his sword. Smoke billowed from beneath the temple walls as the evening air filled with the stench of burning flesh, the buzzing of millions of flies, and the wails of the last few survivors. It had been a good day, Jean de Vézelay told himself, even though he knew his euphoria would soon vanish to give way to a feeling of hollow emptiness, as happened every time he killed. It was never quite enough. Never could be quite enough. He yearned to kill something enormous, something so colossal that it would continue dying forever. If the truth were told, he secretly yearned to face God himself with his sword in his hand. In the company of Hugh de Payen, a 19-year-old lad whose ruthlessness and nice backside appealed to him, he strolled up to the Dome of the Rock and watched calmly as the brutalized pride of Frankish nobility smashed the fabulous decorations within the sanctuary, stealing the gold and precious stones. Jean de Vézelay had no interest in the beauty of architecture, but this elegant octagonal structure with the bare rock at its heart attracted him. He was about to head back to the camp with the satisfaction of a man who had achieved everything he had set out to do, intending to savor the euphoria of the day, when he noticed the entrance to a little grotto at one side of the rock. From it, a steep stone stairway descended down into the darkness beneath the rock. Vézelay was surprised that none of the marauding knights had noticed it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.